Hello, everyone, and welcome to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. I am the RPG chick, and my voice does not normally sound like this. I am getting over some laryngitis, so please bear with me. I can't really talk any louder than this. Interesting Pillars of Eternity technology. If I talk any louder than this, my voice starts to crack, and words start to go missing. I am getting better every day, so you should be hearing me getting better every day with each episode. I'm only going to play an episode a day so as to save my voice as much as possible. Anyway, I would like to thank the following Patreon patrons: Joey Forsman, Meerkat, Sam White, Aaron Hopkinson, and Josh Atkinson. Thanks so much, guys. If anyone else watching this is interested in contributing to my Patreon, think of it as a tip jar or what have you. Strictly voluntary. You guys watching is all I need. But anyway, if anyone is interested, the link is in the description for my Patreon. I am playing this blind, meaning I've never played it before. I read all the things, so I'm going to be reading everything that's not voiced. And I've also played Planescape Torment as well. You can click down here if you want to access that playthrough, and then you could actually hear my voice, how it normally sounds when it's not screwed up. So, yeah. Anyway. Options. I like to show you guys the options. This is pretty much the same. I haven't changed anything here. I changed the text size to large, as maybe it might show up better on YouTube. Everything else, pretty much the same. Controls, pretty much standard for this kind of game, isometric, old-style RPG. Graphics. Of course, I have anti-aliasing high. I don't think it goes any higher. Nope. There's no ultra or anything. The sound I have like this, I think it was pretty much set up like this, but I can hear myself over the game, so hopefully you guys can hear me just fine. And that's it. We're gonna start. I really played like 20 minutes into the game, and that's about it. And that's without me reading. So the rest of this will be completely blind. I will be female. Your mind wakes in darkness. Okay, never mind.
Aching cold sets into an unfamiliar body. A distant howling surrounds you, louder with each passing second. Insistent and invisible hands slap and tear at the membrane that protects you. Your first emotion is an involuntary and formless panic. You feel you have forgotten something, something important. As if it once meant the world to you, but the details slip away as you grasp at them. You force your eyes open.
I'd be more concerned at this point looking around.
A white-pink fleshy cocoon surrounds you. Even as you look, a minor rent in its side tears open, and the howling wind forces its way inside.
So we're surrounded by a pink fleshy cocoon? Like a body?
The cocoon rips away, gone before you can grab it, spinning you into a dizzying tumble.
Uh-oh.
You are falling, the world many kilometers beneath you. You catch a glimpse of a curved horizon, and also the ground beneath you that is approaching deceptively quickly. Above you, a small moon is slowly collapsing in upon itself, a corona of acid green and black energy playing around its edges. The wind buffets you and burns your eyes, but you don't need to see the details of the faraway ground to know you're in serious trouble. You won't survive a fall from this stratospheric height. A part of your frantic mind battles that technically you probably fell from a thermospheric height. You struggle to stay focused as the ground rushes toward you.
try to judge how far it is to the ground.
I guess that you started at least 100 kilometers above the ground. Assuming you fell from a dying moon, that is. You've been blacked out for some time now, and now it looks like you're perhaps 50 kilometers up. Maybe less.
Let's try to remember what happened.
It's hazy. You were in a tall passageway, its sides slicked with dew, the air warm and moist, as if you were caught in the breath of a giant organism. You remember fleeing in fear and exhilaration, laughing through the terror. What was it that pursued you?
No idea.
Something ancient and cold, its coiling power, the promise of oblivion. Its shadowed tendrils struck at you, and the walls where they landed were torn apart utterly, destroyed beyond any hope of repair.
The Sara.
You leapt into a membranous cocoon and fell from the station, the moon. And then you were empty. But who were you? What was that creature? A word surfaces in your thoughts, and you seize it before it vanishes. Sorrow. The world fills your sight. You're about to hit.
Huh. We can't stop our fall, so we might as well try to remember the sorrow.
It hurts your mind to recall, but you push past it, a creature of the forgotten world seeking you out across the centuries. But it's not you it seeks, is it? It sought the man whose memories you shuffle through now. And you realize suddenly that you are not him.
Correct.
You were... who? Who were you?
Let's continue to search the memories.
If you somehow managed to sidestep everything you know about anatomy, physics, and death, and you were surprised to realize that you do know something about them, and you survived this fall, you suspect that you might be able to reawaken a dormant strength you sense inside you. But who could possibly survive a fall from this height?
I have no clue.
You remember reaching an escape tube, and you remember being struck by a tendril of force, and then the fall.
Escape tube?
You open your eyes in time to see a riot of color around you, your descent barely slowed, and then agony flares throughout your body as a crunching impact destroys you. The last thing you hear is a rapidly cycling line of energy, and then... Darkness.
Darkness. Alright, so we're in this strange place. So, I hope you guys don't mind my voice that much. It's just, I really want to play this game. You understand? I've been wanting to play it since Tuesday night, and it is now Saturday night.
Yes.
Jumbled thoughts cloud your head as you study the empty bowl before you. Drops of liquid fall from the ceiling, spattering on the ground next to the bowl. The light from every drop is reflected in the bowl's rounded hollow, as if it hungers for that light and needs to be filled. Yet the bowl remains dry. Another drop falls from the ceiling and splashes across the pylons. Wasted. Let's examine the bowl. You trace your fingers over the slippery, overlapping scales that spiral up from the bottom of the bowl. The sharp-toothed rim plucks at your skin. It's going to be tricky to move this bowl without slicing your fingers on the edge. You might have to put some effort into it. Reflected light streaks across the surface of the bowl as another droplet falls from the ceiling. So we can examine it again if you want to. The slick overlapping scales have sharp, hungry edges that nip at your flesh. Each shining drop of light from the unseen ceiling seems to linger in the bowl's polished depths. How many times can we examine this bowl? Same. Okay. Let's carefully move the bowl beneath the liquid. Okay, our first task. Might, speed, and intellect. 3 stat pools you can spend to increase your chances of success. This is called using effort. 2 more easily move the bowl in front of you. Use mousy to spend might for a higher level of effort. Don't worry if you fail at this task. In Torment, failure often results in interesting outcomes. Okay. Well, then this might be interesting. Oh, wait, I have to continue first. So we can only go that high. Wow. Success. You carefully take hold of the bowl, avoiding the teeth and the serrated rim. With a deep breath, you move it over the glowing pool of fallen light. Okay. Drop by drop, the bowl fills, ripples spreading over the blurred outline of your reflection. A pale blue luminescence stretches into the corners of the room. A clear radiance spills across the segmented floor, washing away the nearest shadows and pouring into your mind, melting the ragged edges of your fragmented thoughts. You are not whole, not yet, but you have begun to heal from the damage done in your long fall. A voice calls out from somewhere high above, beyond the reaches of the spreading light. Hello! Are you still alive down there? We're up here! Build a path up to us and be careful. Okay, dude. So we can zoom in and out.
Yes.
The rippling surface of the bowl shines with its own light. What if we overturn it? When you touch it, you feel a strange tightness in your head and soon discover that the bowl is far too heavy to move now. Even the attempt makes your arms ache and temples throb. Well, I don't think we should try that again then. We can examine this. Metal waves roll over the floor below, sending vibrations through the soles of your boots. This mirror looks strange, as though what you see in it is real and you're the reflection. Huh. Alright, well, let's go this way.
I'm going.
She's going.
Yes, now.
Mess with this thing. As soon as you touch the orb, a memory floods your mind. You stand in front of a rusted door. The air is humid and dank. You've had a moment's respite from this waterlogged hell. A bubble of stale air, your resting point. You've breathed water before, and you've lived decades beneath the waves, but this body's an air breather, and the constant pressure has been crushing you ever so subtly. Worse, your companion's mind seems to be wandering from the task at hand. He's a genius with machines, as you well know, but now he seems distracted. The device in his hands is covered in knobs, wires, and antennas. He believes it can get the two of you through the corroded door, but he's merely staring at it. Perhaps he's lost faith in his invention, but that is hardly your concern. This mission cannot be delayed. It must proceed. We can deceive him, threaten him, or fix it ourselves. Well, it's not very nice, so this is taking too long. Cast a spell, an esoteric, to fix the device yourself. You mumble a few words, drawing power from the air around you, until a solution appears in your mind. You snatch the device from his hands, rewire it, and shove it back at him. Oh, he says, examining your work. Sorry, I was trying to improve the thing. He waves the device at the door, and the stale air of your bubble freshens as the door swings open. A dark hallway lies beyond, a passage that links the water-bordered cells and the aquatic viewing areas. What you seek lies there. Moments later, you're underwater again, your hands closing around a strange yet familiar artifact. You need it to complete something. It hovers above a pedestal, rotating in the dark water. An electric current runs through your fingers as your hand crosses the vertical plane of the pedestal, and an iridescent field coalesces so fast that the wave of pressure dazes you for a moment. The rising pulse of a sonar alarm ripples through the water. Wait, where? Oh, the guards won't be far behind. Let's disable the sonar pulse. You focus on the cloudy base of the pedestal. Your fingers instinctively find the control panel for the jeweled force field, almost as if you had built it in the first place. You remove it, casting it to the side, and you reach inside to deactivate the crystals that power both the pulse and the pedestal. As you remove them, a scaly hand falls on your shoulder. Your head whips around, and you see only the inky blackness of the Piscean Eye. The memory begins to fade, as if you are being drawn backward through a tunnel, and you hear more pylons rising from the pit. Something is wrong. The events within the orb have settled into that gap in your mind, but the edges of it are rough, as though the memory itself is not truly yours. There's something else, a gust of sour air pulling at you, like a predator inhaling the scent of its prey at the far end of a dark, whispering field. Okay. So we are the last cast off. Inventory. So equipment goes here. Melee and range weapons, shields, armor, ornaments, and bonded items. Backpack. Right. Which everything is in here, which I thought was the... Okay, they're talking about here. Okay, so the previous tip was for this. This is the backpack. Inventory. Oh, quest items here. Special items cannot be discarded or sold. Good to know. Can I move this window? No. The final section shows the ciphers you are carrying. Is that this? And your cipher limit. Ciphers are shown in the inner rings. In the inner rings are highlighted in blue and are safe to carry. Those in the outer ring, highlighted in orange, are over your cipher limit and inflict negative effects as long as you're carrying them. You can use, sell, discard, or transfer them to another party member to get back under your cipher limit. Yeah, that's all this. Okay, so we have... Well, nothing. We have 20 health. Reduced to zero, we awaken in the calm, wherever the hell that is. Maybe that's where we are now, the calm. They are knocked unconscious. Lasting damage, fettle. Unfortunately, I can't... It looks like I can, mouse over that, but it disappears. That's our effort, right? What would you just use before to move that ball? Here's our evasion, willpower, fettles. We can have four more party members, I'm guessing. Unfortunately, we cannot change the portrait of this character. I'm not even sure if we could change the name at some point. Dominant Titus Idealist. These people might be capricious, or they might live their lives in balance. Valuing both investigation and action, power and kindness, society's good and the good of the individual. Those who continue this path are not beholden to any one ideal. They are flexible, open to a variety of solutions for each situation. Most find this is not an easy path to follow for very long. Right, so we're going to start with this, this Tide of Numenera is the idealist. And eventually, with my playstyle, we're going to find out which tide I'm going to be, will be the dominant one. So, we have no abilities, we have no exploration skills, combat skills, or inability. And there's no quests, either in progress or completed. Okay, so this is the Dark Fathom, which is not necessarily the Calm. And we have a little thing. This is where we are, party member. Scene transition, sleep location. Yeah, this stuff isn't here. see a way to get there. The light around the door's frame dims and flares like a roaring fire in a high wind. What about this one? Countless scratches and wounds mar the surface of this door. Someone made a great effort to get inside, to no avail. No sign or symbol tells you what might be behind this enormous door. A dull chill radiates from its bronzed, segmented surface, and the thick metal wheel seems frozen in place. Okay, so we have another orb thingy to interact with. You stand beside a woman on a verdant crag. Beneath the two of you is a broad plateau towering above the overgrowth far below. Strange machines have been built into the cliffside, presumably for reconnaissance or defense. A metallic disc gleams from the center of the plateau. Your self-aware humanoid machines drill into the base of the cliffs below. If you were looking for a sanctuary, and you were, desperately, this seems like the right place. I don't know about this, the woman says, her voice flat, neutral. Her face is turned away from you. What makes this place any more secure than the other ones we found? Let's draw her attention to the hidden details that your more experienced eye can clearly see. You shade your eyes against the bright sun so that you can point out the thin bands radiating out from the metallic disc. How the energy from those bands affects the local fauna, suggesting an enormous source of prior world energy. She thinks deeply. It's geologically sound? Have you run the sounding samples and checked the strata? No major caverns or weaknesses showed up on your resonance scans? She waits for your affirmation and says, "All right, I'm convinced." The two of you sketch your plans for the sanctuary, drawing schematics and architectural diagrams. Then you descend onto the plateau to examine the open ground. The woman suggests having one of the servitors build a shelter for your time here. You try to draw one of the constructs away from its task, but it doesn't respond to your voice. When you lay a hand on its shoulder to reinforce your command, it whirls and strikes you across the face with inhuman speed. It turns back to its task, ignoring you. Your companion helps you rise, laughter in her eyes. It seems your construct has other ideas. What's the matter with it? So why'd the thing hit me? Use the Numenera integrated into the construct's body to overwhelm the behavior malfunction. A mist falls onto the plateau as you activate the time-scarred artifacts fastened to the construct's behavioral core with a sub-vocalized command. With an abrupt clack and a pulse of pleasant warmth, the devices purge the error, and seven copper-banded spheres drop out of evenly spaced rifts in the air. Ignoring this common side effect, you give new orders to the malfunctioning construct in a firm, clear voice. Acknowledged. It obediently trundles to the site of your new shelter. The image freezes, then fades, and you feel the memory filling the gap in your mind, block by jagged block. You stagger, clutching your head. Reclaiming your memories hurts. And once more, there's something else. Hairs lift, one by one, on the back of your neck. Something beyond this room can sense what you are doing, and is hunting you. So,
on it.
Apparently we go this way. So these are memories from past lives. A vision of a city springs up around you, your city in flames and under attack. Her defenders have fought and died all day, and still the attackers keep coming. They fight as if your destruction were demanded of them. They care nothing for mercy, surrender, or plunder. What they want is blood. But you have brought a keen-eyed companion to the top of the tower. She has seen the way to stop the invaders. You need to get her to safety, and you need to rally your defenders. But even as you turn toward the door of the tower, two of the attackers descend from a hovering machine. You don't have time to strike at them before they land. One is brutishly large, his weapon a vibrating axe. The other is slim, sheathed in glassy armor, and holding a hilt with a sizzling invisible blade. Your companion backs away. She's too young to help. Your enemies advance single file, confined by the parapet. Fight defensively and figure out who presents the greater threat. The memory seems crystal clear. The giant is menacing, it's true, but the invisible blade of his companion is more worrisome still. The energy field that flickers and wavers around it suggests that she can carve matter at the molecular level, tearing pieces of her target into nothingness. If you are to save yourself, your best bet is to tackle her first. She's stuck behind the giant, waiting for her turn to attack you, unable to bring her weapon to bear until he's out of the way. But it's clear that she expects him to handle you, and her eyes rove behind you, her focus on your ward. She's certainly not expecting you to dive between the giant's legs and come up inside her guard. She can't bring her blade to bear in time, and you drive your dagger up under her chin. You catch her before her deadly blade drops onto you and spin her around. The weapon slashes into the giant, and he topples, bisected. The immediate threat ended. You focus on finding a way back to your allies. You open the tower door and rush down the stairs. The door at the base of the stairs is slightly cracked, opening just a bit into the hall, and you hear more of the enemy soldiers beyond. Let's crack the door open to sneak past them, stealthy. You press yourself against the gleaming door, easing it open, and your breath catches in your throat as it squeaks quietly, the sound like a bell in your memory. You pause, but the soldiers in the hall continue to talk. You push again, squeeze yourself through the narrow opening, and creep down the blood-stained hall. The memory begins to fade, and you find yourself back in your own body. Your temples throb with the racing force of your heartbeat, and the reclaimed memories blaze within you, like a bonfire on a mountain peak, visible to every predator for kilometers around. A tremor rocks the floor beneath you, as though a massive fist has struck the room itself. Swaying on your feet, you see frantic movement within the borders of a mirror at the edge of the room. Okay, so let's head toward that mirror, which is actually like where the reflection in the mirror is real, something like that.
Yes.
Oh yes. The border of this mirror is lavishly decorated with a dizzying number of interlocked symbols. Daggers, masks, paintbrushes, amulets, and more. But that's nothing compared to what you see in the glass. You see a vast crowd of people, exact doppelgangers of you, shoving, arguing with, and fighting each other. Most are drab imitations of you, but a precious few are vivid and pull at your attention. Each of them bears an intricate pentagonal tattoo on their head. In their eyes, their actions, you see the memories you discovered within the orbs and the choices you made, shining like distant stars. Your hand twitches at your side, and though some of the bright doppelgangers ignore you, an even smaller number immediately turn to you, waiting for you to choose them and learn what you might become. A rumble shakes the room, and a slow vibration spreads from the darkness below, rippling towards the ceiling. Excuse me, guys. Sorry, my throat. Let's point at the intelligent doppelganger with the furrowed brow. The doppelganger holds itself erect among the pressing crowd. It meets your eyes with a confident gaze, triggering familiar memories in the back of your mind. When you return from your contemplation, the doppelganger is waiting for your decision with a knowing smile. Yeah, I kind of like that. Yes, that is who I am. So I've just chosen who I am. So we've gained descriptor intelligent. Oh, cool, nano. Okay, the remaining doppelgangers scatter for the edges of the mirror and vanish. Your chosen identity steps forward. Its appearance changes as it steps out of the rippling glass. Its face exudes intelligence and confidence. Shadows of several devices shimmer all around it. Technology of several kinds from a myriad of past ages. You get the feeling it, you, would be comfortable with all of it. The word nano sounds in your mind. So now, nano is basically, in this setting, is like a wizard. You also have a glaive, which is a warrior type. General speaking, anyway. There's different kinds of glaives, I believe. And the jack, which is a jack of all trades. So, of course, you can... Underneath that, I believe, are several different play styles. You know, I'm sure nano, you could have, you know, someone specializing in illusions, like a combat mage or anything like that. So anyway, I'll be right back, guys. Now, normally I would end at just over 30 minutes like this, but we've barely seen anything, so I'm going to continue. So this episode, guys, will be a little longer than most. Your doppelganger continues walking, stepping into you, filling you, making you whole. Your decision rings out into the cavernous room, awakening and unlocking vast mechanisms behind the walls. Suddenly, a grotesque noise rings through your shared worlds, like a bell if bells could rot. Something is coming. So our two might have been restored. So it sounds like a bell, a rotting bell. The mirror fades, leaving a dark, open doorway. You take a deep breath and step through. Your choices in the memories and the mirror have begun to build your character, but now you have the opportunity to decide on a number of details. First, you can decide to change your type. Type defines the abilities and skills you'll be able to acquire as you advance. So we're an intelligent nano, which I like, so I'm going to keep that. So, to save my voice, I'm not going to read about Glaive and Jack. If you guys want to read it, I'm just going to read it to myself, and I'll read it nano. Right, scouts, guardians, warlords, and soldiers. Jack of all trades. A resourceful hero who always seems to be named Jack. That's pretty cool. This does have an appeal to me as well, but I want to be a powerful wizard type. Most games I want to be a powerful wizard type. So nanos are sometimes called mages, wizards, sorcerers, or witches by the people of the Ninth World. Whatever they're called, nanos master the mysteries of the past to the degree that they seem to perform miracles using esoteries, spell-like invocations that combine gestures, command words, and psychic disciplines. They tap into nano-spirits, numinous particles that suffuse the landscape, to alter reality or learn things that they couldn't otherwise know. So for you guys, for anyone who doesn't know, this is the Ninth World. There were 8 civilizations preceding this world. I'm not sure where we are now, but the majority of our adventure takes place on Earth, which is... I forget, it's either one... I believe it's 1 billion years in the future. And all the technological you know, devices and particles, emanations, everything are left behind from these civilizations. So where you might seem to be playing in a medieval style and there's magic, it's really medieval. It's so changed it's barely medieval anymore, and the magic is actually its technology. And most people don't know how most of these things even work, so to them it is magic. Pretty interesting, huh? So we got plus 2 intellect pool, 2 points to distribute to any pool, plus 5 health at each tier after first, gain 2 abilities at each tier, can pick 1 lore skill at tier 1. So concentration increase, cipher limit, so wait. Nanos gain a free level in the concentration skill. Practice with handling ciphers allows you to carry more without risking ill effects. Right, back to that other thing we were talking about before. An onslaught. 1 intellect. Target 1 enemy. Medium range. Choose a damage type. Deal 5 damage of that type and confer a minor additional effect based on the choice. Plus 1 damage per effort applied. Max is plus 6. Novice is plus 0%. Defended by willpower. Assail your foes' bodies or their minds with a blast of summon energy. Cool. So we already have this thing. Okay. So we're going to pools next, I'm guessing. Yes. Stat pools are the resources you use to apply effort or activate abilities. You can distribute points as you see fit. Glaives tend to favor might and or speed, while nanos favor intellect. Jacks usually benefit from a balanced set of points. So I'm going to do that. I'm going to take intellect. Intellect represents the character's mental prowess, willpower, and personality. Every 2 points in intellect also increases willpower by 5%. So we have 1 remaining. I'm going to put both into intellect for now. I do plan on increasing these at least a little bit. I just think it's important to really start off strong with intellect as much as we can. Character creation. Yeah, abilities unlocked by your type can be active actions such as attacks or spell-like esoteries or unique passive effects. Okay, so this I want to take because this helps with your dialogue. Scan thoughts. The surface thoughts of most people or creatures you speak with appear in conversations. Right? Otherwise, if you don't take this, I'm thinking it's missing, right? While speaking with the inhabitants of the Ninth World, you will sometimes hear their thoughts. This is often helpful, though rarely appreciated. Well, I think I will appreciate it. It's just them who will not appreciate it. So I'm going to take 1 in... Can I take 2? No, it just removes it. I wouldn't want to. Resourceful? Hold on. This allows you to carry additional ciphers. Remove all negative fettles, except for flank and lasting damage. Heal 6 points of health. You can use it 5 per day. Channel a subtle esoteric through the body of an ally, purging most negative effects from them and healing their wounds. I think I want that. Let's just see what this is. Adaptation, for allies in immediate area, short range, gain protected, plus 2 armor, plus 1 resistance, armor bonus plus 2 per tier, resistance bonus plus 1 per tier. Surround your allies with a cloud of nano spirits that will defend them against damage. Okay, so it's a buff, it's an armor buff, and a resistance against spells, right? And we have Quantum Step, which is teleportation. Teleport one ally to a point within range. Distance is an illusion. You can manipulate space to create a shadow door and draw your ally through it to the other side. That's neat too. This stuff is all pretty interesting, but I think healing is important, so I'm going to take innervate. Most skills increase your chance of success on specific kinds of actions and tasks, but some give other passive bonuses. Each skill starts at the novice level and can be increased to trained and specialized, gaining greater bonuses at each level. Descriptors often leave some skills at the inability level, meaning they inflict penalties. When upgraded, these return to the novice level. Okay, so we have Anamnesis, which is trained, right? Plus 15% bonus per level in difficult tasks marked with this skill. The last cast-off can access the memories of previous consciousnesses. This skill represents your focus and acumen when attempting to recall those experiences. Okay? So we already have this, and we have inability in heavy weapons and medium weapons because we're a nano and we don't have any points in might and stuff like that. So we can take lore on machinery, academic knowledge of machines, mechanics, and the physical sciences, lore for mystical, knowledge of sciences that are not exactly physical nor natural, including strange or transdimensional creatures. Cool. And then natural sciences and physical creatures. This really interests me. Machinery as well, too. It all looks cool, but I think I'm going to take lore mystical. Can I take another, or just one? Nope, just one. Lore mystical for now. Really interested in a strange or transdimensional creatures. Pretty cool. Okay, so we don't get weapon skill. We're going to completely bypass that because only glaives receive training. Really, not even Jack, huh? Although you chose your descriptor from among the many doppelgangers in the mirror, you now have the chance to view the specific bonuses and penalties it grants. You can also examine the effects of other descriptors and choose a new one if you wish. So I'm just going to go through this really quick. Cautious, careful and meticulous, always aware of your surroundings. Charming is a smooth talker and a charmer, able to convince others to see things your way. Clever, quick-witted, and a good judge of others. You can fool yourself, but are rarely fooled yourself. You can fool people, sorry, but are rarely fooled yourself. You are not great at retaining trivial knowledge, however. Graceful, quick, lithe, and dexterous, able to move with grace and beauty. Intelligent, which we have. Sharp memory and can grasp concepts that others struggle with, though you have a tendency towards distraction. Learned, you are studious and know a great deal of information about many things. You have few social graces, however. Mechanical, you have a gift with machines and the technology of the ancients. You are not as good with people, though. Mystical, gift with the Numenera, especially the stranger powers of the ancients. You're not as good as with people, though. So you lose out an intimidation skill and deception, persuasion, when you take things like that. Observant, you pay attention to the smallest details, noticing clues that others often miss. I like that. Rugged, you love nature and pitting your wits against the elements. You are tough, as befits a life in the wild. People and machines are something of a mystery, though. Slick, you're a fast talker and a fast thinker. You're not the toughest around, but you can easily manipulate situations such that you don't need to be. Stealthy, you're sneaky and slippery, both in actions and words. You gain advantage through stealth rather than speed. Strong, physically powerful and have a presence to match. You aren't extremely deft or clever, though. Strong-willed, You are willful, headstrong, and independent. You know that self-confidence is more important than facts. Swift, your top speed is unmatched. You may not be the most dexterous, but you're fast. Tough, you can take a lot of punishment, shrugging off blows that would down most people. And wrathful, you are quick to anger and have the power to back that anger up. Now if you choose cautious, we lose initiative. But we have concentration, mystical lore, perception, and stealth. So, like, if we would take something like that, we would lose the training we just took in lore mystical. Not gonna do that. Concentration, healing, lore mystical, lore machinery, and lore natural. I like that. Unfortunately, we're not as good as persuading and deceiving people. So I think I'm going... Wow, yeah, we take mystical, we get an extra. If you really want to focus on that. And we get cipher use as well. Concentration. I do like perception. And notice things in the environment that you wouldn't normally. Very useful. Concentration. Quick fingers, huh? So if we take stealthy, we actually get some training in light weapons. Concentration. I kind of like stealthy. Strong-willed. Smashing, huh? The finely honed ability to break things. That's funny. So I'm stuck between stealthy and learned. So you got light weapons, concentration, deception, lore mystical, and of course stealth. Concentration, healing, lore mystical, lore machinery, and lore natural. I'm kind of thinking that if I take stealthy, it's going to be easier for me. But I'm going to pick learned. I think it's going to be more of a challenge, but it's going to be more interesting. Yep. Last chance gas.